Hello and welcome. I'm Professor Tsuchiya, and I'll be guiding you through this introductory course on using Simulink to simulate dynamic systems. Now that we have our block diagram programmed into Simulink, we can call it from MATLAB to run various simulations. Remember, the Simulink model simply represents the dynamics of the system, and once it's programmed, we can use it at any time. Let's start by opening up a new script or M file in the MATLAB environment. Let's immediately save it and give it a logical name. Since our Simulink model was called carVelocitySim.slx, we can name the corresponding M file simply carVelocity. It can really be named anything that makes sense to you, but be sure not to name it the exact same name as a Simulink model. Once we have our M file set up, we can start coding. We'll begin by clearing the workspace and the command window, which is relatively standard practice. Then we need to define the variables that are used in the Simulink model. Remember that we left the mass and drag coefficient, m and b, in symbolic terms in the Simulink model. Thus, they need to be defined in the MATLAB workspace before we can actually run the simulation. Let's choose some arbitrary values for now. With these variables defined, we can now call the Simulink model and run the simulation from this M file. The function sim performs the same task as opening the Simulink model and pressing the green play button, but it does so from within the M file. There are two basic arguments you should specify in the sim function: the Simulink model name as a string, and the simulation time in seconds. So, this line of code will run the Simulink file named carVelocitySim for 30 seconds. Just make sure that the Simulink file you wish to run is in the current working directory. This shouldn't be a problem if you save your M file and Simulink model in the same folder. As with any other MATLAB M file, the code is executed line by line. Let's test the code so far by running this script. Once the code is finished running, we should see the variables m and b, but also any output of the Simulink model should appear in the workspace. Recall that we had two workspace blocks in our model, one for the velocity named vel, and another for the simulation time called time. You may also notice the default time vector called tout that has been introduced in recent releases of Simulink. The fact that all of these variables are now in the workspace means the simulation ran successfully. However, the purpose of writing a script like this is not only to run the simulation, but also to do some analysis of the system response. So, below the sim function, we can perform any number of tasks to look at and analyze the simulated output. For example, we can plot the data to visualize it and produce professional plots for later use. Executing the code now does all of the previous tasks, but it also makes a nice plot with appropriate labels and titles, all from running this single M file. If we wish to change the simulation at any time, all we have to do is open the Simulink model and make the desired changes. For example, we can change the type of input forcing function that's applied. Instead of a constant input, which represents depressing the accelerator pedal to a constant value, let's suppose someone oscillates the accelerator pedal in a sinusoidal fashion. Why someone would do this, I can't say, but we can still run the simulation nonetheless. Running the M file now shows what the output velocity looks like. As expected, the vehicle velocity also follows a sinusoidal function, but it's apparent that there's a bit of a transient response that eventually decays. Something else to note is the overall blocky appearance of the simulation output. In other words, the simulated velocity doesn't look very smooth as we would expect. This is because the simulation occurs at finite time intervals denoted by the simulation sample time. In other words, in the real world, things happen in continuous time, but in the computer simulation world, things happen at discrete time intervals. We can adjust how many times per second the simulation is run by going to the Simulink model and clicking on the Simulation tab and navigating to the Model Configuration Parameters option. In this window, the first submenu that appears is the Solver menu. In solver options, the default settings are variable step with an automatically chosen solver. This is where the parameters of the numerical integration are defined. Sometimes Simulink isn't the best judge of the solver options, so we need to set them manually. An easy way to do this is to simply change the type from variable step to fixed step. You can leave the solver set to automatic for the moment, but click the Additional Options menu just below, and you'll see a field where you can now set the sample time. Changing it from auto to, say, 0.1 means that we are fixing the simulation to run every 0.1 seconds, or 10 times per second. This implies a sample frequency of 10 Hz. Let's see how that affects the simulation output. First, note in the workspace that when the default settings were used, the output velocity vector is 51 elements long. That means that over the 30-second simulation, only 51 data points were collected, which is why it looked choppy. Now sampling at 10 Hz, we should get 10 samples per second for the entire 30-second simulation, for a total of 300 data points. Let's run the script and see. We do in fact see that the output velocity vector changed from 51 to 301 elements long. As a result, the plot looks much smoother since there are more data points to represent the output. Of course, we can change the sample time to anything we'd like, but in general, you want to sample only as fast as required to capture all of the system dynamics. Sampling unnecessarily fast will give you great resolution in your data, but for more complex simulations, it can really slow things down. So we have now run our first complete simulation of a vehicle velocity system, and I hope you have grasped some of the fundamental concepts required for developing your own simulations. In future videos, we'll be applying the same basic concepts that we have already learned to more complex systems. By exposing you to different dynamic simulations, I hope to show you just how powerful Simulink can be as a simulation and analysis tool.